I think it's really unusual and somehow typical of whatever space has been carved out here by various people that help you with that. This kind of conference would be happening here in this zone. That, the question of refugees would be opened up to a field of poetics and not only politics. So I'm not a, just to warn you, I'm not a refugee scholar. No refugees, actual refugees, have been harmed in the making. So it's a theoretical paper, and it has some literature in it, in honor of the question. I say that not just for a laugh, but because there are people, and the day has been filled with really rich papers which do deal in empirical and testimonial and other ways with the reality of the situation. And although I hope it just touches a bit on the reality, that's not its primary intention. I want to begin with what must be one of the most enigmatic sentences in the recent history of humanitarian discourse. The linchpin, no less, of the Nobel Peace Prize acceptance speech delivered by James Gobinski on behalf of Doctors Without Borders almost exactly 10 years ago, in December 1999. Summing up a rather complex argument about the relation of humanitarian action to politics, an argument which begins with the virtually definitional claim that humanitarianism occurs where the political has failed, or is in crisis. Gorbinsky concludes with this more complex paradox. He says, the humanitarian act is the most apolitical of all acts. But if its actions and its morality are taken seriously, it has the most profound political implications. So the question is, what would it be to take it seriously? And how is it possible, this movement from the explicit, public, declared apoliticality to the depths, the profundity of political education. My project this afternoon is to try, with the help of some poetry, to understand what sort of politics is implied here. And in my subtitle, although I don't entirely deliver on this, I suggest that the much maligned notion of neutrality, or maybe suspension, might be a better word, might help us here, provided we start to think of it as a neutralization or suspension of one understanding of politics in favor of another one, of the opening up of the political sphere itself. I'll try to unpack this here. The logic, or maybe the rhetoric, because we'll be talking about poetry, is simple but deeply perplexing. It is as if politics must be suspended in order to find a different route back into it. Two summers ago, I received a pleasant assignment from a magazine. Interview Jenny Holzer about art and human rights. Holzer dispatched me to see her gigantic textual slideshow at the Massachusetts Museum of Contemporary Art, MassMoCA in North Adams, Massachusetts, called Projections. The installation is composed of nothing but the texts of poems, including a number by the Polish Nobel Prize winner Wisława Szymborska, slowly scrolling across the floor and walls of a vast former industrial space. The focus is on the words, and many of the poems are really remarkable. The interview project fell through, but the poems stayed with me, and I thought I'd begin with them today. I want to thank my student, Paulina Gorshin, who guided me through their Polish with patience and generosity. Now, I should be a responsible scholar and have a handout, but I don't. Fortunately, there's the internet. So this is the first one. I'll just scroll through it slowly so you can get a quick sense of the poem. Thank you. Even if you don't know the Holzer project or Jim Worshka's work and just read the poems here quickly, you'll notice, I'll show you another one in a second, that they share an interest in politics, but not an uncritical one. In a way that seems not too hard to understand, given Jim Worshka's experience in Poland before and after 1989, they seem to juxtapose what they call politics with an idea about something that remains, in a sense, other than or different from it, or maybe more precisely about something that can only be inscribed, not entirely legitimately, into politics. There's a hesitation about politics and, in the second element, about memory as a kind of totalizing force. It would be tempting to call this an ethics or a morality, an anti-politics, which resists the contaminated values of politics, contaminated by power, by ideology, by interest, and so on, with a more fundamental set of principles that take human being or experience itself as their point of reference. But I don't think this is an adequate account of the complex operation of Jim Worshka's intuition. The poem which addresses this directly, are children of our age or children of our epoch, treats the process by which things become political with great ambivalence. Its irony is caustic, corrosive, but it does not entirely dissolve its object. The poem begins with an accelerating catalog of the ways in which apparently innocent, and even intentionally apolitical, that's her word, features of our lives seem ineluctably to wind up captured by politics. She says, whatever you say reverberates, whatever you don't say speaks for itself. So either way, you're talking politics. More literally, actually, it means whatever you say has a resonance, whatever you think has a say. Either way. The poem worries by its end, though, about something else. The shift is subtle, a bit asymmetrical, but decisive. It does not directly challenge the claim that everything is political. It betrays a healthy respect for the ways in which nothing seems to be exempt or exemptable from this process, which cuts across the whole of the spectrum, so elegantly captured in the possessive pronouns. All affairs, yours, theirs, ours, nightly affairs, daily affairs, are political affairs. But having said this, there is something else to say, it says, something removed or distinct from the apparent totality of everything or whatever. The poem does not qualify this difference or characterize its status. It is not a fact or a precondition or an outside, not nature or the heavens or human life itself. We have already been warned away from seeking refuge in a notion of brute humanity or materiality. Quote, to acquire a political meaning, you don't even have to be human. Raw, actually the poem says recycled material will do, or protein feed, or crude oil, or a conference table whose shape was quarreled over for months. In relation to politics, there is nothing that can remain fair or raw. Everything is available for political investment. We can understand this in two contradictory ways, depending on how we read the rhetorical status of the claim. Perhaps this is simply a realistic assessment of our present epochal condition. Like it or not, politics conditions the time and space of politics, and there's no escaping it. You should not imagine that there is an outside. It would be naive at best, or willfully evasive at worst. No retreat, no inner immigration is possible. You will just be kidding yourself. And hence you and everything else become available for even worse because passive appropriation or political signification. Politics pervades and constitutes every feature of human and non-human existence, and you had better get engaged with it. One could imagine this critique offered by politicizers or activists of various stripes. The personal is political, or silence equals death, for instance, would be rebellious or emancipatory versions. And there would also be more sinister versions, which the state or other authorities seek to legitimize bureaucratic or administrative or juridical control over every aspect of life. That's one version. On the other hand, perhaps this is a protest, a mocking or satiric challenge to the claim that everything is political, an exposure of its false, superficial, wishful desire to totalize, a sort of revictio ad absurdum. You say everything is political, and so I'll literalize it. Everything, really everything, from eyes and skin to day and night, speech and thought, moon and ground, even poems, even apolitical ones. Perhaps even this very poem is something you want to take over, annex, instrumentalize for political purposes, or endow with political significance. Then, the very existence of the poem would form a de facto rebuttal, an ironic critique from within the target itself. The high or low point of that counterpoint would be the quotation from Shakespeare, which appears in the middle of the poem. It reads more literally, "To be or not to be, that is the question. What kind of question, tell me, dearest? A political question." Here, in the cliche and the citation, human being and non-being itself, prior to any other determination, is brought into question as political. And its absurdity would be revealed in the example of the conference table's shape. Should we arbitrate life and death, being and not being, at a round table or a square one? Yes, that choice had to be made, but it shouldn't have, the poet would be saying. So is it a concession? Yes, I admit nothing escapes politics. An affirmation or an imperative politicized. Or a protest, resist the tyranny of the political. I am not sure the poem will allow us to decide this. The residue of this ambiguity or undecidability shows itself at the poem's end, which I show you again. Because there's something else happening alongside this incessant and ravenous politicality or politicization. However we read the poem's evaluation of it. Zhvorshchik introduces it with a temporal qualifier, meanwhile, in keeping with the poem's sense that politics is a historical feature, ours is a political age, a political epoch. Meanwhile, the poem says, and in Polish it maintains the present perfect tense, people were perishing, animals were dying, houses were burning, and fields were running wild. As in times long ago and less beautiful. This catalog of destruction, dead people, animals, houses, assessed now in a temporal dimension, has a kind of permanence that politics doesn't have. Now as then, these things happen. Politics changes along a scale of less and more, but these things continue to happen. It is against the background of this continuity, which is not exactly natural, that different sorts of politics might be assessed and judged. Perhaps that is why things need to be made political, need to acquire political systems. Because at other times, the times are less political, and yet destruction still goes on. In that sense, politics cannot account fully for perishing people, dying animals, burning houses, wild fields. On the one hand, it is not simply to blame, but on the other hand, it is not an answer either. The problem, the poem seems to say, is that politics thinks it can account for everything. I'm going to switch powers. Sorry, that's a cool thing, but I'm going to do this. In her presentation of Zimborska for the 1996 Nobel Prize, Birgitta Trotzig of the Swedish Academy said, quote, "For Zimborska, as for many other contemporary Polish poets, the starting point is the experience of a catastrophe, the ground caving in beneath her, the complete collapse of her faith. In its place, human conditions break in with their inaccessibly shimmering agitation, their dailiness and pettiness, their tears and their jests, their tenderness." Unquote. Although it is precisely the system of pathos, contemporary economizing, and sing-song rhythm, which is completely absent from Zimborska's work, bankruptcy is right to point to the collapse of grounds as a major force in this poem. But what are the human conditions which seem to take its place? There was a powerful current in the Eastern European dissident movements which saw in the vocabulary and strategies of humanitarianism and human rights something like this, a replacement for or a challenge to politics, a post-political position, even an anti-political one, a set of fundamental claims that would precede or outlive politics with a reference to something else more basic, an ethics or a set of norms which might put some limits on the extent or the pervasiveness of the political realm. Although it's obviously related, Szymborska's poetry is darker and more complicated than that, and clearly resists the lure of both a naive humanism and a rejection of politics. A second poem included in Holzer's installation, this one called The End and the Beginning, illustrates this complication with a truly severe rigor. In it, war and politics go together, and then there is again something else, a leftover which demands attention. And those who attend to it. I'll let you read it now. After every war, she writes, someone has to tidy up. Things won't pick themselves up, after all. One can't, without too much difficulty, imagine this as a motto for an austere and sober humanitarianism. It assigns a task and an agent. Someone must, someone has to, it repeats four times in the first four stanzas, and explains why. There's nothing automatic here, and intervention is required. It means something must be done, but it turns that necessity into a sort of personal responsibility. It does not specify the agent, though. It remains open and anonymous, an empty position waiting to be filled by someone. The poem does not say who should do it, nor that anyone can, but only that someone must. Because something has gone wrong, someone has to respond. Without giving into the vocabulary of innocent victims and something caught in a crossfire, poem nevertheless seeks to distinguish the target of that intervention, the remains of the war, what the title calls the end, from the reasons and actions which preceded and caused them, the beginning. It assigns a certain priority to the aftermath and its attendants, and describes the labor of tidying up as a practice of undoing and erasing the remnants of destruction, of eliminating the residue and replacing it with something new. Rebuilding is something like destroying the destruction. The labor is long and not simply visible. Photogenic it's not, says the poem. The line is translated, no sound bites, no photo opportunities. Photogenic it's not. But it's also even somehow self-erasing. Shirt sleeves will be rolled to shreds. On the other side, as it were, the positions, the poem calls them arguments, and forces that brought the ruins into being also have an afterlife, but it fades with time. Someone, bloom in hand, still remembers how it was. And then a little later, those who knew what this was all about must make way for those who know little, and less than little, and finally, as much as nothing. That's the literal translation, the more felicitous English, nothing less than that. Someone has to lie there in the grass that covers up the causes and effects, with a blade of grass in his teeth, gawking at clouds. That's the last one. Although the poem's emphasis at its beginning is on the human agency of those who tidy up, who deal with the after effects and the rubble, corpses and bloody rags, by the end of the poem, this agent, the poem only always calls it someone, has nearly merged with the more powerful forces of meeting, which is to say, forgetting, that are metaphorized by the grass that grows over the causes and effects. Tidying up seems to involve at once a necessary rebuilding, burying, recovery, getting on with things, but also an intentional forgetting, even a radical one at the end. Nothing less than nothing. It is not a recovery or a restruction, a reconstruction, not the reestablishment of an original condition distorted by destruction, but the erasure of the destruction, the picking up, parting off, and disposal, covering up, of the results of war and arguments. Are the renewal and the oblivion essentially linked? That is there no future unless the disputes and words that produce the war and constituted the knowledge of what this was all about wind up finally under the grass, disappeared, erased from the archive? The imperative of the first line seems to suggest this. There is no living in the catastrophe, only after it. And making that life possible is a different task altogether from the one that brought on the war. It seems again as if we could read this two ways. Either there never are sufficient reasons to account for a war, so forgetting them is not particularly bad. They're better off forgotten, actually. This would be the force of the metaphor rusted arguments, the rusted arguments that someone must dig up and haul off to the dog. Or, on the other hand, is the poem suggesting that it's unfortunate that we humans need to tidy up so thoroughly, tend or even intend to forget, because then we stand very little chance of recognizing those causes and effects when they rematerialize. The poem's sense of the true disaster of war suggests that the stakes are high. Is the work in the rubble an essential antidote to war and politics? The reassertion of something that differentiates us as someone from the arguments, which are always destined for the dump? Or do we clean up those arguments at our own peril? The poem offers us no ground on which to decide between these two alternatives, which are, of course, diametrically opposed, and thus exposes us to the difficult task of sorting it out ourselves. But the poem does distinguish between this dilemma at the level of what ought to happen on the one hand, and the level of what has to happen on another. Perhaps it would be better if we didn't always destroy things, but we do. And because of that, there is work that must be done. The causes are one thing. They happen, they rust and fade away, disappear into their own inexorable irrelevance. They were important enough to kill and die for. Now they are boring, forgettable, and soon enough forgotten. But there is something else, the work on the results, on the rubble, which is not reducible to them, which does not belong to the same logic. Responds to them, but not symmetrically. It is not a counter-argument. It does not engage. It does not belong to the order of what this was all about. It does not even really pertain to that discussion. Someone remembers, someone listens, others overhear and find it boring, and soon nothing. It doesn't connect to that. This alterity of the response to the order of the argument, of tidying up to war, is the most striking conceptual feature of the poem. At its end, someone still has a task, to lie uncomprehending on the grave of the causes and the effects as the grass continues to grow. I don't know if this interests. Szymborska's lines, I think, can help us understand in a new way some of the contemporary debates about what we could call the politics of humanitarianism. The tidying up that goes on in and around, and sometimes with, millions of refugees and internally displaced people on the planet today. I can't do full justice to the debates here, and we've already heard a number of them were rehearsed in really interesting ways today. But with the help of these poems, I just want to sketch for you the basic contours of what seems to me to be a major question about humanitarian action today. And Borges' hesitation about the political and her respect for the labor of tidying up are exemplary for me of a responsible approach to these questions, or rather, of an approach to them which takes the question of responsibility as seriously as it becomes. It is by now a commonplace to associate the doctors and militants of mid-sex and frontier, doctors without borders, I'll talk about this in a second, with the notion of politically engaged humanitarianism. This association is not entirely incorrect in that it describes the commitment of some national sections and activists within MSF to a version of humanitarian action, which extends beyond the simple provision of emergency medical relief to one of speaking out or bearing witness, of taking sides with the victims and denouncing publicly the forces which have turned them into victims. This position grows out of their well-known analysis, the thought process which, in a sense, gave birth to the organization, of the failures of 20th century humanitarianism, sort of practiced by the International Committee of the Red Cross. The Swiss delegates of the ICRC, in accordance with the mandate the organization receives in international law as the guardian of the Geneva Convention, have developed an elaborate ethic and practice of trading access to the victims of war and conflict in exchange for silence about what they find. As one observer has summarized the position, quote, "The ICRC was committed to deliver aid without taking sides or even publicizing its views on a particular conflict. It stood first and foremost for neutrality and discretion, without which its officials believed it could not carry out its mandate. It was the moral limitations of this stance, the realization that in certain situations neither the law nor good intentions were enough, and that only exposing the horror, even if that meant taking a political side, would bring an end, that gave rise to groups like MSF. The French aid group and its numerous successors and competitors consciously challenged the Geneva Committee's assumptions and insisted that aid was above all an act of solidarity, and that when all was said and done, it was impossible wholly to divorce it from politics." The twin experiences of Bosnia and Rwanda in the mid-90s seem to indicate this analysis. In both cases, the predominant public and geopolitical interpretation of the catastrophes was that they were humanitarian disasters, and that emergency relief was what was called for. Both countries were the beneficiaries, as it were, of international relief and aid efforts of massive scope, expense, and complexity. In both cases, the humanitarianization of the conflict meant that A, powerful outside actors could avoid their responsibilities to put an end to the killings, using the generosity of the aid and relief effort as an alibi for the absence of determined political responses, and that B, powerful local actors could instrumentalize and exploit aid and relief to fuel the conflict and hold international forces hostage. The humanitarian response at once depoliticized the conflicts and contributed negatively to their length and severity. Some agencies and analysts drew from these experiences the lesson that a robust humanitarianism was going to have to give up its innocence and get involved with politics wholeheartedly. As I mentioned, some parts of MSF, along with a number of other leading agencies, began talking about and operating in a way that sought to incorporate the taking of political sides, whether in terms derived from human rights or more obviously ideological discourses, into their analyses and operations. And governments around the world began recasting political projects as humanitarian ones. Interestingly, though, a considerable current of opinion within MSF resisted this move, and on unusual grounds. Led by Ronnie Brownlot, who was president of the French section of MSF for much of the 80s and 90s, and now heads its Paris research office, this group argued that it was only by distinguishing, as rigorously as possible, the sphere of humanitarian action proper from the political realm, that one could avoid the simple and massive instrumentalization created by politics, which had occurred in Bosnia and Rwanda, and then a few years later, much more obviously, in Kosovo. For the sake of the political, in other words, humanitarianism needed to be separated from it, but with care. Here we can rejoin Wierzbicki in his Nobel Prize speech, which summarizes with some eloquence this line of thought. I'll read you three short paragraphs. Humanitarianism occurs where the political has failed or is in crisis. We, and he means MSF, act not to assume political responsibility, but firstly to relieve the inhuman suffering of failure. An act must be free of political influence, and the political must recognize its responsibility to ensure that the humanitarian can exist. In this dysfunction, we will speak out to push the political to assume its inescapable responsibility. Humanitarianism is not a tool to end war or to create peace. It is a citizen's response to political failure. It is an immediate, short-term act that cannot erase the long-term necessity of political responsibility. There are limits to humanitarianism. No doctor can stop a genocide. No humanitarian can stop an ethnic cleansing, just as no humanitarian can make war. And no humanitarian can make peace. These are political responsibilities, not humanitarian imperatives. Let me say this very clearly. The humanitarian act is the most apolitical of all acts, but if its actions and its morality are taken seriously, it has the most profound political implications. Perhaps we can begin to untangle this enigma now, at least negatively for a start. MSF is clear about the consequences. When the border between the political and the humanitarian is not honored, aid and relief can easily become weapons of the worst sort of politics. Respecting this boundary is what they call technically creating humanitarian space, understood as a conceptual as well as a physical zone, in which aid organizations are, and I'm quoting Fiona Terry from MSF, permitted unhindered access to populations in need, are able to assess independently the needs of vulnerable groups, and can themselves control the distribution of relief supplies. These criteria, which seem technical, work to define a no-go area for armies and politics, a sphere in which aid alone can be provided, and likewise identify a separate space in which the work of fighting, denouncing, advocating, and politicizing can go on, in which responsibility can be assigned, criminals named and punished, and political solutions pursued. But the humanitarian, quoting Wierzbicki, act itself must be free of political influence. In an interview with Michelle Thayer, Brauman insisted on this paradox, not for its own sake or for purely conceptual reasons, but as an operational strategy with a strikingly minimalist argument. The more bare the humanitarian project, the better the chance for politics, for a politics which does not seek to hide behind or exploit humanitarianism. He defended, he said, quote, the modest idea that politics, history, and the future are written by and with the living, and that if you are on the side of the living, the minimal policy consists in caring for bodies. I would once have rejected this. Today I am advocating it as a minimal, and thus not imperial, policy. Caring for bodies means taking meaningful action to help those who otherwise would have tremendous difficulty surviving, helping them get through a difficult period, whether it is a period of 6 months or 6 years. That's an interview in the book that Thayer edited called Non-Governmental Politics. It should be clear that Brauman intends this as a critique of humanitarian practice, which he worries has become imperial, on its own and in collaboration, witting or unwitting, with governments. This position, which Brauman shares with David Reif and Abed for the Night would be the classic text of that tendency, and a number of other internal critics of mainstream humanitarianism, constitutes in some respects a rewriting or a return to the classic Red Cross stance, and is thus not without its critics. The most interesting one is the French anthropologist Michel Agier, who has put the problem bluntly, if generously. Citing Brauman on humanitarian space and expressing appreciation for MSF's struggle, both, he says, to shelter humanitarian intervention from the military and political pressures of warring groups, unquote, and to grant it an independent status and legitimacy. Agier nonetheless asks, quote, what happens to this legitimacy when the emergency is transformed into a lasting and permanent arrangement? And humanitarianism, based on exclusion from politics, is transformed into a situation of power, an instrument of political manipulation, or an internationally accepted principle for governing the undesirables of the planet. And that's actually the title of one of Agier's recent books, Governing and Managing the Undesirables. Agier, and in this sense he might be one of the inspirations for a conference like this, turns the focus away from the would-be apolitical position of humanitarians to the status of refugees themselves. They're defined by their temporary status. They are accidentally or arbitrarily displaced, and in their refuge do not, cannot, and often do not want to behave as if at home. But the temporary risks always becoming something more permanent. They have no right to work, cultivate, or settle, and by extension are deprived of the social alliances and affiliations which constitute everyday normal life, including the sense of belonging to a political community. Life, Agier writes, is given to them by the humanitarian principle. The application of this principle establishes a contradiction between minimal biological life and the social and political existence of individuals. When the 6 months grow into 6 years or longer, he asks, might humanitarians then find themselves acting as low-cost managers of exclusion on a planetary scale, without this being any longer a matter of emergency, accident, or accident? Represented at its minimum by the living that humanitarianism addresses, is unthinkable without politics. But politics does not, cannot account for everything in that life, even if it has the potential to acquire it. We can see a rich, almost ironic structure. By evacuating the camp, one understanding of politics, which is the apoliticizing move, it opens space for another version of politics, an attempt to reclaim the right to politics, to practice it oneself, not simply to be the political object of others. Let me see if I can rephrase that. Politics does not, cannot account for everything in life, even if it has the potential to acquire it. More importantly, it can account for the entry into politics itself. Here we can glimpse, or maybe gawk at, the risk, the rich, almost ironic structure of the MSF argument. By evacuating the camp of politics in one sense, in the gesture of apoliticization, it seeks to open up a space for another meaning of politics, to foster what we might call the right to politics, the right to practice it oneself, and not simply to be the object of others' interventions. Zimborska's someone, after all, could just as easily be a refugee. Thank you very much.